loved Haverhill, Massachusetts. He loved his brother, all six of them, and his beloved sister, Juliet, and all his nieces and nephews.
Our grandfather loved the Navy. He loved the Susan March. He loved being a drummer. My grandfather loved music. He loved leading the Navy show band.
Our grandfather loved the United States of America. My grandfather loved drinking Moxie. He loved his dogs and his garden. He loved Skyline Drive and he loved South Jersey Beach and lobster dinners.
My grandfather loved his kids and grandkids. He loved 1209 Van Buren Drive. He loved Halloween and Christmas decorations. Lots and lots of them.
My grandfather loved the drum corps. He loved the 4th of July parade, or any other parade for that matter. And he loved cooking spaghetti dinners.
My grandfather loved being bandmaster of the New York Military Band. He loved watching leaves change color on Storm King Mountain.
My grandfather loved his Miss Muddy. He loved picking the first daffodil of the season and bringing it to her. My grandfather loved life and lived it to his fullest.
We love him and we will miss him and we never forget him.
As Irving Berlin said, the song has ended but the melody lingers on. Thank you.
I'd like to introduce Mr. Tony Scudo and Terry, who I always know as Terry Quick.
American country artist Kevin Welch wrote, "There'll be 2 days on your tombstone and all your friends will read them. But all that's going to matter is that little dash between them." Frank Forgione's life is identified as that of husband, father, musician, World War II Navy veteran, and band leader. But in reality, Mr. Forgione's dash is much more. Growing up, I had the pleasure of being one of Frank Forgione's drum students and a friend to his three children, Frank, John, and Tricia. We spent many hours at the Forgione home dreaming of greatness in the rock band we were sure we would one day play in. While I didn't learn to be a great rock star from Mr. Forgione, I did learn other more important lessons from him. As my drum teacher, Mr. Forgione couldn't be fooled when I didn't practice. He'd heard all the excuses before, and would let me know that lack of honesty and hard work showed in my playing. I didn't understand then how those drum lessons were teaching me more than how to play music. Mr. Forgione was teaching me something that would last well beyond his lifetime. He was teaching me how to be a man. I've tried to live my life as if I was at a lesson with Mr. Forgione, watching over my shoulder, honestly, hardworking, and with no excuses.
Good morning. I might need a tissue. I had about 5 pieces of paper with handwritten notes on it that I was going to bring today. And thank you very much. I notified Frank that I might not participate in this today, but I think it's pretty important because everybody needs to have all kinds of different perspectives of who Mr. Forgione was. I started playing music in 1970, and I thought I was rather good at it, and I was interested. But as time went by, the people that I came to know who were my instructors and my teachers at school and the school system, I became very disinterested. And at a certain time, I began to feel like I was going to give up on that. One day, about 1975, in my very uninteresting band class, we had a substitute. And a gentleman walked in a suit, blue jacket, if I can recall correctly, a black tie, a suitcase full of music, it turned out, and a bounce in his step. I call that charisma. And what that did to me that day was to allow me to pursue many more years in music. I don't do much of it anymore, though I wish I did. But he kept me going in many ways more than that. Personally, he was a mentor. I got to know Mr. Forgione over the years. I spent quite a bit of time with Tony and the other guys at the house. Trisha and I, we were the only girls, right? Except for maybe Rose when she came along. But in being there, we got to know a different Mr. Forgione, and it wasn't all about the parades. It wasn't all about the competition. It turned out for us, it was about the camaraderie, about the friendships, about his place in our life and our place in his life, I hope, I think so. For many of us, as I read on the blog on the internet, he was more or less, the father that we may not have had or the parent that we may not have had at the time. He was always willing to step in. He was always cheerful, loving, giving advice, listening to our stories, and hopefully we did him well. I hope we did, because we loved him very much. So on behalf of the Fort Washington Continentals, I would like to thank the Forgione family, Frank and Trisha and John, and their kids in Alberta, because heaven knows she had a house full almost all the time. We want to thank them for having us there, for being a part of our lives, because we love them very much.
Okay, I guess I'm the MC. I'd like to introduce Mr. Mike Beegle, XX Navy Show Band.
He's on his way.
I don't know any tricks, but here come my hand. Okay.
Excuse me.
This is Frank Spolman. We took up a collection and bought this for him. We wanted everybody to know that Frank, first of all, was associated with the show band. We especially wanted everybody to know he was in the Navy.
No.
Frank Forgione was the father of the Navy show band, or La Banda Unitas, as it was known in South and Central America. He was also responsible for changing the face of Navy music. He made 12 trips south, and those of us that made the trip with him can attest to the fact that it was very grueling, very difficult, and extremely rewarding. It was the most memorable tour of duty that I had in my 27 years in the Navy, and a lot of us can make that statement that for career folks. The same goes for the musicians that traveled south over the trail that Frank blazed under the stirring leadership of people like John Fluss. Right back there. Tex Waldron, John Paston, and many others. And the tradition continues. He was a goodwill ambassador without equal, a patriot of the First Order, a Pearl Harbor survivor. His ship was sunk in the attack, and a showman extraordinaire. He gave new life to a very old tradition in Navy music dating back to the days of Artie Shaw and Sam Donahue, the big band. He made it possible for us in the band to experience what it was like to be in a musical organization that everyone loved, all ages, all backgrounds, and all nationalities. Truly, Frank was a star, and he gave us more than our 15 minutes of fame. He was also a great humanitarian and loved his musicians. To be fair, he didn't always have time to make warm and fuzzy with the band. He was, after all, on his own, most of the time, away from the ship, in country, and without any other naval authority present. Well, he did have Carl Halisa. He was a taskmaster, a demanding leader that insisted on a professional performance every time out, and he got it. I can remember many a time being on a formation on a pier to play honors. The flagship tied up alongside the pier. Frank would call a tune from the show. We didn't have the music. We didn't have drum equipment. We didn't have a PA system. It didn't matter. He knew we could do it. He trusted us, and we did it because he told us to. That band was so good, and we had so much fun. I can't tell you. I really can't tell you. Frank once told me, when the Navy was considering taking some billets away from the show band, that it didn't matter because if they gave him a bass drummer, he'd put on a show. And it was true. There were times that, as with any leader, we grew a bit restless with his rather gruff approach. That was understandable on both counts. However, with the passing of time, I've not spoken to one musician that served with him that didn't come to understand just what Frank had accomplished. He truly showed us magic, and we all loved him for it. I had occasion to spend a good deal of time with Frank after he retired, and even worked for him on several occasions with the Navy band Port Authority, which was a rock band in the Navy band. Rest assured, he loved all of us in return. He had nothing but fond memories of his men and the job that they did for him. And he talked about it all the time. He never stopped talking about it. After his retirement from the Navy, Frank had a very successful second gig as director of bands at the New York Military Academy. There has been a tremendous outpouring of love and affection for him from his former students at the NYMA. There is no question that they loved him as much as we did. I asked Frank Jr. if his dad still identified more closely with the Navy, and he told me, I couldn't believe this, that his dad actually requested permission to wear his Navy uniform as leader of an Army band. There's no question that Frank loved his NYMA students, and they loved him in return. But in his heart, he was always a sailor. We're paying tribute to Frank with a reunion of the Navy show band, the first ever. I'd like to share a poem with you that was written by a Navy musician on the occasion of the first reunion of the 12th Naval District Band, San Francisco, California, in 2005, from the years 1961 to 64. This is a poem written by MU2 David L. Novak, and it's entitled A Treasury of Thoughts. I think that you will see that this is very appropriate for the occasion. The years of the young are long and spend themselves with glee. We bunch of lads with fearless futures stayed and played with thee. It's going to be tough. With instruments for voices, our melodies echoed long. And in the night, by the firelight, in silence, we heard our song. A song of joy and brotherhood and companions who joined in union to pledge without salute to our mutual lives and this reunion. We wandered far, and with time to spare, we thought we'd never grow old. The trails we trod are longer now, but our hearts is still as bold. God graced this place with musicians who came with keen anticipation to play in a band whose leader was all our inspiration. We embraced the finest of the fine in music and in wine, both flowing through our veins like ambrosia for the sublime. The years of the old are shorter and spend themselves with thoughts of our band, our travels afar, and images we wrought. To find a way in your life requires friends who guide but not steer. In doing so, we learn to climb that mountain without fear. And when we leave this place, a part will remain behind. For a better bunch of buddies in our lives we'll never find. With instruments for voices, our melodies echoed long, and in the night, by the firelight, in silence, we sang along. Thank you.
When my father retired from the Navy, he decided to go back to school and, of course, join the circus and all kinds of things, crazy things he loved to do. But he had a wonderful teacher, professor at Catholic University, Eileen Mangers, and she's here this afternoon. She'd like to say a few words.
Hello, everyone. 35 years ago, my very first stint teaching college, English 101, I was assigned the jock class with a few musicians. So the jocks, namely basketball players, lined across the back and snoozed quietly. And the few English majors sat in the front. Fred sat right dead straight ahead of me. Well, back then I had the power to be able to release people from 101 if their writing was good enough. And so I gave them a test for them to write something. So I came back and I read through their essays, and I called up three people. One of them was Frank, and gave him the opportunity to leave because what he wrote was one of the best things I've ever read. I also had a little question for him, because he wrote about the sinking, the incident at Pearl Harbor, and the sinking of his ship, and what it was like afterwards. And, well, I was just a little suspicious. It was so beautifully written, so poignant, and he seemed so young. I wondered if he had really written it, but he had. He told me then that he was in Pearl Harbor, and I was floored. So he declined the opportunity to skip my class and get the credit for it. He said he wanted to stay and learn whatever he could from me. And I don't know that he learned so much from me, but I know I learned a lot. Was just the very best student I ever had, and one of my very best friends. He was like a combination of a best friend, best uncle, and a godfather. And he gave me great guidance and encouraged me with whatever I did, encouraged me to get back to my music. Yes, I played, let's see, flute, clarinet, the cello, piano, and the organ, and I just loved hearing him regale me with his stories. By the way, none of them well, except maybe a little bit. But he tried to get me back into music, and I just loved hearing his stories. And he bragged about his family so much, and the Continentals, and then Nine people, and I just love hearing him talk. And I also became a bit of a friend of Alberta's. You know, Alberta is a very generous person. His whole family is very generous because they shared him with me, and that was so. It was one of the best experiences in my life, having him, having Frank for a friend. And I knew all about you now. But all I can say is I loved him very much, and I feel the love and the warmth here, and I'll never forget Frank. Thank you.
I'm going to move this little anchor. When my father died, I began the immense task of trying to compile some sort of commemorative retrospective DVD of his life. The task was beyond daunting, you can imagine. My father's life was amazingly documented through photographs, either U.S. Navy official photographs, and through us as well. So I sifted through everything as best I could, and I came up with this. I hope you enjoy it.
Yesterday, December 7, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Thank you. So I each and every one of you, I looked at the speeches and the presentations and the heartfelt emotions that folks had from Frank. And all I could say was, wow. You know, you look at a life of that nature and all he's done and all he's inspired, it's just amazing. I had my boys and my wife come up earlier and they did well and they didn't cheer and I'm just about to, so I'm going to be real careful. Just this weekend, we were at my mom's house, and my brother went to the basement and got a bunch of books from that I read in high school. And he pulls out Day of Infamy, not knowing. Trisha goes, go to page 71, I think it is?
72.
71, 72. And on that, in that page it says, and Frank Forgione, in the Navy band, got off the ship, you know, barefoot or something like that. And when I read that in high school, little did I know that at page 72, my life was going to be so touched by that action. And, you know, he gave me many gifts. First was his daughter and the family that I have today. But the second is the gift of life, the gift just to have fun. You know, I'm a banker, I'm kind of practical, and to just go do it, stop, go all out. Do the best you can, you know. We just put up the witch that he handcrafted 40 years ago at our home. And I tell you, we have lots of decorations, and the one that everybody talks about is the witch with the black light. And there it was, with a hammer and some string and trying to put it up. And I felt a little bit like I was touched by him, you know, being there. So the gift of my family, the gift of just living life. And just a gift of just music. And oh, my boys are musicians now, and they're playing, and it's just a big, big part of a life. So I know he's changed my life. I know he's changed yours. Here's to Frank, his life, his legacy, and his family.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.